Hey guys, we're back in Anna's lab this week to show you a couple steps that didn't make it into the first iteration of how to taxidermy a squirrel. But first I wanted to remind you that we've got an Indiegogo campaign that's running through the end of the month, and we could really use your help and support. I mean, it's a pretty cool project in that your contribution or just sharing the video or whatever could help build something that will be here for literally a century or more. So if you could just check it out or share it or just give a thumbs up, we'd really appreciate it. And now, more squirrels. Are there brains on this thing?
Yeah, there might be some starling brains from here. These are my brain scoops.
It seems to me there's kind of three different ways to preserve an animal and three different objectives. So one, we have the study skin, which is used for research. Two, you have like commercially produced, mass manufactured taxidermy. Mm-hmm. And then there's museum taxidermy, which seems to be the more artistic one.
Yeah.
Where do you see yourself in those three things?
I like doing a mix of museum stuff now. I mean, that's where ultimately I'd really like to be.
Yeah.
And doing the commercial stuff too, just because when you're doing client work, they really generally don't want anything overly ornate. They just kind of want their animal either from the hunt or wherever the animal came from. They just want it from the memory. I really want to start getting into doing weird poses and just like awkward moments in the animal's life. A lot of people, when they do bears, they make them really aggressive. Mm-hmm. I like when they're kind of panting, when they just have their little lower jaw just like slightly overhanging like that. So like you can just start to see the teeth.
When you're talking about recreating these animals kind of after they're gone, not every bear is spending all of its time growling, just like you said. So I think it's super important to think like where museums come in with dioramas is that we are trying to capture those individual moments.
Little moments.
And like the habitat. And sometimes it's just like grazing.
Yeah.
Because that is probably what that animal spent 90% of its life doing.
Yeah, definitely. And then for the eyes, we'll see if the scalpels will be able to handle this foam. What I like to do is I actually cut this brow off. So now we just want to dig in here so that we can set in our eyes. And it depends on the eyes you're using too. So like the bubble eyes, they go in a little bit deeper. If you're just using black glass beads, they're not going to go in as deep.
What's the difference between a bead eye and a bubble eye?
These bubble eyes come from a supply company and they're hand blown, so you can see the little little guy in the back.
Oh, nice.
And they kind of have a little bit of a purpley black color, whereas the black glass beads are just, I mean, they're jewelry beads, and they're just solid black. And the thing that's nice with these is that you can find them locally, and when you're looking at a squirrel, unless you're looking really, really close, you're not really going to see that brown iris that they have.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're first learning, it can kind of drive you crazy lining up the pupils, so you can just go solid black, and once you get a little bit more advanced, you can go in with doing your iris positioning and everything.
Or you can do like Soon Raccoon and just put rocks in the eyeballs.
You could just put rocks, yeah. So we just want to hollow these out a little bit, and then very carefully with our blade. So if you're using the glass beads, you just want to make sure that your bead holes go up and down vertically so that you don't end up seeing them.
Oh, gotcha.
Because you always see more of an animal's eye in the front and back corners. So we're going to use the eyelids to cover up those holes. Yep, so just up and down, straight into the eye socket, just like that. And we could even set it in a little bit deeper. And then you just want to soften up that clay around it to form an eyelid.
It gets cute all of a sudden.
And you can build a little bit more up top. The best thing to do when you're doing this is to have reference pictures all over the place. So you can use that to look at to figure out, you know, like eyelid shape and everything.
So that's kind of crazy.
It's starting to look a little bit more like a squirrel. As soon as you start putting eyes in, everyone
a very surprised
gets really, really excited.
Squirrel.
He's so cute.
So what I'm noticing right now is that not only is my skin slipping, but also it's really wet and it looks kind of greasy and like not so pretty. How do we make it look like a pretty squirrel?
Nice squirrel later, just to continue brushing the fur as you go, just to keep it from getting kind of like ruffled like this.
Okay.
But for these guys, we're just going to get them all sewn up and we'll do the face and then we'll brush them and fluff them up a little bit with some sawdust.
There's a lot of slack. Like he could have used a little more foam.
You want it to be a little looser because taxidermy means moving of skin or movement of skin.
Mm-hmm.
So if your form is too large, it's going to look too inflated. So you
like
want
fat?
It to be slightly smaller than your skin. So what I like to do is you got to find the corner of your mouth so you can see on the skins right about here.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's line this up on our form. So it's like right about down here with the modeling tool. So now we are tucking our lips down into our form. All right.
Okay.
So we can pin your guy a little bit. So I like to do a pin in each corner.
So I want to put this pin in the corner of the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
What does that do?
So this, you push the skin down into those slots that we made, but we also want to just make sure that they stay there while they dry. So we're just keeping these pins in here to hold the skin in here.
So the skin is underneath the pin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we're just doing this so that it stays in place as it dries.
Kids, this is what it's like to get facial piercings.
Right now, because these guys had a couple bald spots or slippage spots, I'm just kind of folding the skin over those bald spots so that we don't end up seeing them.
It's just beauty tips and tricks.
Yeah, just fixing them up a little bit.
I think he looks pretty good now.
Yeah, right? He looks pretty much like a squirrel.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Right?
Final step is finishing touches.
Grooming.
With a hairdryer.
Yep.
And
right.
A brush.
So we want it on either low or no heat.
Okay.
And then you can start blow drying it. And you always just want to kind of back brush it very gently. We're not brushing too much. We're basically just lifting the fur up away from the form.
So, you seen anybody? Or... I feel like a beautician. But I don't know any beauticians who have blow-dried a dead squirrel.
It still has brains on it.